Hello everyone, welcome back again to the Indian News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. These are the list of news articles that we will be discussing today, and they are provided along with the page numbers of different editions. And also the link for the handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping for the discussed articles is given in the description box as well as in the comment section for the benefit of our aspirants. Now let us move on to the analysis of the first news article. Now look at this article. This article is about a statement that was released by the Commerce Secretary on Tuesday. And in a statement, he questioned the rationale behind the US government's decision to put India on the watch list for currency manipulators. And he also said that the watch list is an intrusion into the policy space that is needed for the central banks around the world to meet their mandates. Now let us discuss this topic in detail. The syllabus relevant for this article is highlighted below. See, the US Treasury Department had recently retained India on a watch list for currency manipulators. Note that India was added to this list last year, and the reason cited by the US Congress for adding India to the list is the higher dollar purchases, which was found to be close to 5% of the GDP by the Reserve Bank of India. See, the threshold of US when it comes to dollar purchases is only 2% of GDP. But India has purchased almost 5% of GDP worth of dollars. So this is one of the reasons why India was there in the list. Also, another reason for the inclusion in the currency manipulator watch list is the $20 billion trade surplus that India has got with the US. See, the trade surplus is an economic indicator of a positive trade balance in which the exports of a nation outweighs its imports. When you take India, India's trade plus with US is currently more than $20 billion. Now here, it is interesting to note that India's trade surplus with the US grew by about $5 billion in the year 2020 to 21. That is, the trade plus grew from $18 billion to $23 billion in this year. And the US finds this to be illogical because the imports of US from India fell more sharply compared to exports in this COVID-affected year. So when viewed on this angle, the trade plus should have decreased, but that is not the case. So the US suspects currency manipulation to be the reason for this increase in trade plus, and therefore has retained India in the currency manipulator watch list. Now, in this context, let us see about these currency manipulators. See, the term currency manipulator is a label that is given by the US government to those countries who engage in unfair currency practices by deliberately devaluing their currency against a dollar. See, this devaluation is the reduction of the official value of a currency in relation to other currencies. And this practice would mean that the country in question is artificially lowering the value of its currency in order to gain an unfair advantage over others. This is because the devaluation would reduce the cost of exports from that country, and it will artificially show a reduction in trade deficits as a result. Now let us see how a country is decided as a currency manipulator by the US. See, the US Department of the Treasury, it publishes a semi-annual report wherein the developments in global economic and exchange rate policies are reviewed. And in this report, the Treasury Department will also include the watch list for currency manipulators. See, the US Department of the Treasury, it uses three criteria to decide whether a country is a currency manipulator or not. And if a country meets any two of the three criteria, then it is placed on the watch list. And the three criteria taken into consideration are as follows. First comes the $20 billion plus bilateral trade surplus with the US. Secondly, the foreign currency intervention exceeding 2% of the GDP. And thirdly, it is a global current account exceeding 2% of GDP. See, this current account surpluses refers to the positive current account balances, meaning that a country has more exports than imports of goods and services. Now, when it comes to India, it meets two of the above three conditions. So, it was placed in the watch list. Now, here you should note that the designation of a country as a currency manipulator does not immediately attract any penalties, but it tends to dent the confidence about a country in the global financial markets. So with this, we have come to the end of this article. So in this discussion, we learnt about the currency manipulator's watch list and also about the criteria for its determination. Now let's move on to the next news article. Now look at this news article. The news article talks about travel bubble. First, let us see what is this travel bubble and then we will move on to the news. See, this travel bubble is nothing but the air bubble, which is also called as transport bubbles or air travel agreements. See, air bubble is a temporary international bilateral agreement between two countries which aims to restart commercial passenger services that were stopped in the wake of the pandemic. That is, as you know, as a result of the COVID-19 pandemic, the regular international flights were suspended to and from India, and similar was the case with other countries as well. So these agreements provide for restarting such suspended passenger services. And these agreements are reciprocal in nature. That is, the airlines from both countries enjoy mutual or similar benefits, and the tickets for these flights are sold through the airline's website, travel agents, and also through global distribution system. Now, if you take India, it entered into air bubble agreement with more than 25 countries, like that of USA, Canada, France, Germany, UK, Maldives, UAE, Qatar, Afghanistan, Bahrain, etc. So, under the air bubble agreement of India, flight services are operated between the destinations of party countries. For example, India has created an air travel arrangement with Bahrain. And the Air India or the Air India Express and Gulf Air are permitted to operate services between India and Bahrain and to carry certain categories of persons on such flights. Now, from India to Bahrain, airlines are allowed to carry Bahraini nationals or residents and any Indian national holding any type of valid visa from the Kingdom of Bahrain and destined for Bahrain only. And then reciprocally from Bahrain to India, airlines can carry Indian nationals who are stranded in Bahrain and all overseas citizen of India cardholders who are holding Bahraini passports. Also, it can carry from Bahrain to India the Bahraini nationals, including the diplomats, who are holding valid visa issued by an Indian mission in any category covered under the Ministry of Home Affairs guidelines that is amended from time to time. So, based on these, air bubble agreement flight service between Tiruchirappalli in Tamil Nadu and Bahrain was operated in September 2020. See, the main benefit of air bubble is that such agreement and resulting travel helped, and in fact it is continuing to help, to bring back stranded Indians from abroad to India and unite them with their families. Now, in this line, recently India's Civil Aviation Ministry announced that it will set up a bilateral air bubble arrangement with Sri Lanka, and this will be for the operation of special international passenger flights between the two countries. But today's news is that due to the surging COVID-19 cases in India, Sri Lanka has postponed the launch of proposed travel bubble with India. Now, this travel bubble is important for both countries. When you take Sri Lanka, it is important to Sri Lanka as its economy has been deeply affected by the pandemic. So, it wanted to open its tourism sector, which contributes a considerable amount to its economy. Particularly, tourism also forms an important link between India and Sri Lanka, as India is a top source for tourist influx into Sri Lanka. Note, as per available Ministry of External Affairs data, over 42 lakh Indian tourists travelled to Sri Lanka in 2018. On coming to India, it is important to India also as air connectivity is important to help the Buddhist pilgrims in Sri Lanka to visit important religious sites in India. Now, here you should note that Sri Lankan tourists are among the top 10 sources for the Indian tourism market. With this, we have come to the end of this news discussion. Now, let's move on to the next news article. Our next discussion will be based on this news article. This op-ed article is written by the head of Epidemiology and Communicable Diseases, ICMR. And in this article, the author discusses the vaccine hesitancy that is shown by the Indian people when it comes to COVID-19 vaccination. See, according to the World Health Organization, vaccine hesitancy is a reluctance or the kind of refusal that people exhibit when it comes to vaccination. However, this is not a new phenomenon because it was already observed in Britain during the vaccination against whooping cough in the 1970s and also against measles in 1990s. And even in India, there was a hesitancy during the polio vaccination campaign initially. And even now, India is experiencing the same kind of vaccine hesitancy when it comes to the COVID-19 vaccination. See, the problem is India is now seeing a second wave of COVID-19 cases, and the number of cases and the deaths are increasing day by day. So at such a juncture, the COVID-19 vaccines can play a major role in countering the disease and in reducing the fatalities. Also, it can save lives and it can reduce the demand for healthcare services at government and private facilities due to COVID-19. But yet, despite such direct and indirect benefits of COVID-19 vaccines, many are still hesitant to accept these life-saving scientific interventions. Now, why are people hesitant to accept vaccines? See, the vaccine hesitancy is a very complex phenomenon for which there is no easy answers. And also, it is often extremely localized to the region and has got socio-cultural context as well. But however, today's digital technology has given this vaccine hesitancy a new momentum. For example, misinformation spreading online through the social and digital media channel have heavily contributed to this vaccine hesitancy. And India is particularly vulnerable to this challenge because we are increasingly moving towards consumption of news and information online and also through social channels. So this kind of misinformation can adversely impact public trust. So, what can be done? See, building public trust through clear and transparent communication is an important measure in order to counter this vaccine hesitancy. And this can be done by equipping the healthcare professionals and the frontline workers with accurate information so that they can counter misinformation. Also, garnering the support of trusted local and community leaders can build credibility of vaccines and can remove vaccine hesitancy. In addition to that, the author also suggests spreading positive messages proactively in the community and also on social platforms, since this has reduced vaccine hesitancy in other countries. And the author finally concludes by saying that we need to understand and we need to address our community's concern with empathy, because only with such empathy we can gain the trust of people when it comes to vaccines. And this will eventually help us to create a healthier world in future. So with this, we have come to the end of this news article. So here we learned about vaccine hesitancy, reasons for vaccine hesitancy, and also on the solutions for vaccine hesitancy. Now let's move on to the next news discussion. Now let us take up this editorial article, which speaks on how to make India a low-carbon economy through a sector-led and action-based approach. The syllabus covered by this article is highlighted below for your reference. Recently, the US President Joe Biden has invited 40 world leaders to the Leaders Summit on Climate. And this virtual summit will underscore the urgency and economic benefits of stronger climate action. And it will also serve as a key milestone on the road to the COP26 of the UN Climate Change Conference that is scheduled to be held this November in Glasgow. Also, the world leaders are expected to catalyze their efforts that keep the 1.5 degree goal within reach and achieve net zero emissions target soon. See, a recent report of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change also called for global carbon emissions to reach net zero by 2050. So, in effect, all countries, including India, are expected to announce 2050 as the net zero target year. So in this light, the authors in this editorial say that India, being a climate vulnerable country, must also come up with its plan to limit global temperature rise below 1.5 degrees Celsius. And this has to happen considering its own developmental needs, as we are still a developing country with significant development deficit. For example, our per capita carbon emissions are less than half the world average. As seen in our earlier discussions, India cannot afford to commit 2050 as the net zero year, as it will have to take more burden of decarbonization than many developed countries. And this will seriously compromise India's development needs as well. So the authors suggest an alternative path focusing on near-term sectoral transformations by adopting available technologies. So India shall focus on sectoral low-carbon development, combining competitiveness, job creation, distributional justice, and low pollution in key areas. And in the long term, India can get more specific about net zero targets and timelines. And the author points India's power sector to be an example for this. See, in 2010, 25% of the global greenhouse gas emissions came from electricity and heat production. And the burning of coal, natural gas and oil for electricity and heat is the largest single source of global greenhouse gas emissions. And the authors point out electricity sector to be the single largest source of India's greenhouse gas emissions, contributing about 40%. And hence, decarbonizing the electricity sector is a key to achieve net zero emissions. See, so far, our efforts in the electricity sector are focused on expanding renewable electricity capacity. And our renewable energy targets have grown immensely from 20 gigawatts of solar to 175 gigawatts of renewable capacity by 2022 and to 450 gigawatts of renewable capacity by 2030. And for decarbonizing electricity sector, we need to limit the expansion of coal-based electricity capacity. But the problem is coal provides roughly 75% of electricity today and it supports the key sectors in economy. Hence, decarbonizing this sector won't be an easy task. Therefore, the first step in this direction can be pledging that India won't grow its coal-fired power capacity beyond announced level and will reach peak coal electricity capacity by 2030. At the same time, we should also strive to make the existing coal-based generation more cleaner and efficient. Now, such a commitment would encourage investors in renewable energy sector, thus giving a scope for its full-scale development. Also, the phasing out of coal will reduce the air pollution and help in mitigating climate change. Now, next, the author says that we shall create a multi-stakeholder just transition commission and it shall represent all levels of government and the affected communities to ensure decent livelihood opportunities beyond coal in India's coal belt. And also it is necessary to ensure that the transition cost to a low carbon future should not fall on the backs of India's poor. Next comes the need for the existing problems in the power sector to be addressed. And this includes poor finances and management of distribution companies, etc. And the most important step is India shall work on to become a leader in technologies of the future. And in power sector, this includes areas such as electricity storage, smart grids and technologies that enable the electrification of other sectors such as transportation. Now, in order to create employment and improve global competitiveness, we may partner with the private sector and also use methods such as production-linked incentives. Further, decarbonizing electricity supply by enhancing the efficiency of electricity use is also important. Here, we need to keep in mind the growing urbanization and increased energy consumption. As we know, cooling needs are expected to increase rapidly with rising incomes and temperature. And as per the editorial, air conditioners, fans and refrigerators together consume about 60% of the electricity in households. But most of the electric appliances sold in our market are not energy efficient. Say for example, an average fan sold in Indian market consumes more than twice what an efficient fan does. And it is about 35% more for an average refrigerator. Hence, India should set aggressive targets. For example, 80% of air conditioner sales and 50% of fan and refrigerator sales in 2030 shall be in the most efficient bracket. And this would reduce the greenhouse gas emissions and lower consume electricity bills as well. And not just that, India can also use this opportunity to become a global leader in production of clean appliances. Now, we have a clear way forward for the power sector. Such a sector-by-sector approach shall be developed for other sectors as well in order to achieve net zero emissions without compromising on development. And this will transform India's economic sectors and in fact make them even more competitive. And once this is done and the economy is in a path of transition, then India can commit for timelines to achieve net zero emissions. But before making such commitments, India shall undertake detailed assessments of its development needs and low carbon opportunities. In addition to that, it shall also consider the possible pace of technological developments and a similar net zero targets of developed countries, etc. So, it's time for India to develop a strategic roadmap to enhance in its own technology and manufacturing competence. This is because there are geopolitical and geoeconomic risks associated with over-dependence on certain countries for technologies or materials. And to conclude, the author says that an integrated approach rooted in our developmental needs and the climate mitigation needs will represent an ambitious, forward-looking and results-oriented India. So with this, we have come to the end of discussion of this particular topic. Let's move on to the next news article. Now look at this snippet. It talks about the YSR Zero Interest Crop Loan Scheme launched by the Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister, and an amount of ₹128.47 crore has been credited into the accounts of around 6.27 lakh farmers who had taken crop loan of up to 1 lakh and repaid the amount within the stipulated time. So in this regard, let's now see some relevant details about this zero interest crop loan scheme. See, the zero interest crop loan scheme for farmers is also called as APYSR Sunna Vaddi Panta Runalu Scheme. Now here, this YSR refers to YS Rajasekhara Reddy, the 14th Chief Minister of the Indian state of Andhra Pradesh. Now under this zero interest crop loan scheme, the government will provide interest subsidy on loans for crops. See, this scheme is one of the parts of the earlier launched YSR Sunna Vaddi Padakam scheme, which was designed for women self-help groups. And in that particular scheme, the Andhra Pradesh government had reimbursed the interest paid by the self-help groups on outstanding bank loan up to 3 lakhs. Now coming back, as seen earlier, this YSR Sunna Vaddi Panta Runalu scheme is a zero interest crop loan scheme for farmers. And in this scheme, the state government reimburses all the interests on the outstanding crop loans of those farmers who repay it on time. And accordingly, the state government has now released interest subsidy for the crop loans that were taken during the Rabi 2019 to 2020 season. Now let's see about the loan allotment criteria for the scheme. Note that the loans will be granted to the eligible farmers based on the e-crop data. But however, in the current exercise, even other eligible farmers have also been included. The second loan allotment criteria is those farmers who have taken the loans of up to 1 lakh and repaid it in the given deadlines will get eligible for 0% interest on the loan taken. And also, Andhra Pradesh state government has set up the Raitu Bharosa Kendras in order to make the scheme more accessible to farmers. See, this RBKs or the Raitu Bharosa Kendras are digital kiosks for farmers to know real-time market price and also to place orders. Now, adding to this, it will also be selling products that are tested, packed and graded by the government. And this entire scheme falls under the YSR Raitu Bharosa scheme. And this scheme is an umbrella scheme which also covers crop losses and insurance premiums along with interest-free crop loans. With this, let's move on to the next news article. Now let us take up this news article. The news article mentions that the Employees Provident Fund organization has added approximately 70 lakh net subscribers during 2020 to 2021 financial year till February. And this data was based on the provisional payroll data that was released by it. Now here, the net subscribers include those who have joined for the first time and also those who existed and rejoined while switching jobs. And the data about those who have joined for the first time reflects the number of new workers who joined the formal workspace. And as per the release data, this has reduced in February 2021 compared to January, as you can see here. So in this context, let us discuss about EPFO. See, it is one of the world's largest social security organization, and it is an autonomous body that comes under the administrative control of the Ministry of Labour and Employment. See, the EPF was established initially through an ordinance, and then it was given a statutory backing through an act called Employees Provident Funds Act of 1952. Note that currently this act is referred as the Employees Provident Funds and Miscellaneous Provisions Act of 1952, and it extends to the whole of India. See, the act was enacted to provide for the institution of provident funds for employees in factories and other establishment, And for this purpose, many schemes were framed under the Act, mainly three schemes, which together provide a comprehensive retirement solution to enrolled members. The first is the Employment Provident Fund Scheme of 1952, also called as the EPF scheme. See, it is a contributory provident fund scheme and it provides the accumulated amount plus interest after the retirement of the subscriber or upon his or her death. And additionally, it also provides partial withdrawals of the accumulated amount. That is, it provides advance amounts in case of exigency such as for education, marriage, illness and also for house construction. The next one is Employees Pension Scheme of 1995, and this scheme provides lifelong pension to the member and family. And the third comes the Employees Deposit Linked Insurance Scheme of 1976, and this scheme offers insurance benefits to the kin or family members in case of the unfortunate death of a subscribed member. Now, who administers all these schemes? See, the Act along with the schemes are administered by a tripartite board known as the Central Board of Trustees of the Employees Provident Fund. And this board consists of representatives from the central and state government and the representatives from employers and also employees. Now, this is where the role of EPFO comes, as it assists this body. So, EPFO also administers these schemes and its main duties are to secure compliance and to deliver timely benefits. Also, additionally, EPFO has a well-equipped training set up wherein officers and employees of the organization and the representatives of the employers and employees attend sessions for trainings and seminars. So with this information, let's move into the next news discussion. Now let us take up this news article, which talks about the Directorate General of Civil Aviation allowing the Boeing 737 MAX 8S to overfly India. Now this comes as a move that will enable foreign carriers to operate the aircraft. So in this context, let us briefly understand about this Boeing 737 MAX 8 aircraft and also on the reason as to why it was banned in our country. Now firstly, on talking about this Boeing 737 MAX, it is a new family of twin-engine narrow-body or single-aisle aircraft that was developed by Boeing. And it was based on the world's best-selling aircraft, Next Generation 737. And the new range of aircraft is intended to deliver improved fuel efficiency for the customers in the single-aisle segment. And it incorporates new winglet technology, delivering her fuel burn advantage, and it is also designed to improve the fuel efficiency of the airliners with 8% per seat advantage in comparison to other aircrafts in the single aisle segment. Note that it is powered by the CFM International LEAP 1B engines. Now the specialty of this engine is that it reduces the carbon dioxide emissions by an additional 10 to 12% in comparison with existing fuel efficient single aisle aircraft. Now let us see why this particular aircraft was banned. See, several aviation regulators around the world, including the US Federal Aviation Administration and the DGCA of India, had ordered the grounding of this particular Boeing 737 MAX in the year 2019. And this happened in the wake of the crash of two new aircraft, namely a Lion Air Flight 610 and Ethiopian Airlines Flight 302, within 5 months. And during the investigation, it was found that the main cause for both these plane accidents was a design flaw in the most modern jetliner. See, the latest model of this Boeing 737 is installed with MCAS, also called as Maneuvering Characteristics Augmentation System. See, this MCAS is responsible for pushing the nose of the aircraft down when it senses a high angle of attack that may result in an aircraft stall. See, if the nose of a plane is too high, then the aircraft loses its speed and it is likely to enter a stall. See, stall is a state in which it loses flight and from the sky it can fall like a stone. Now, this MCAS has been designed in a way to prevent such an eventuality. Now, when you take the two plane air crashes, the problem was during the ascent, the MCAS falsely misread the plane's angle of attack and it forced the plane nose down, ultimately resulting in the crash. However, coming to the present, now presently, though this Boeing 737 MAX 8 is allowed to overfly India. Still, it continues to be banned for commercial operations in the country due to its involvement in the above two air crashes. Our next news discussion will be based on this news article. According to recent reports, Russia is planning to pull out of ISIS collaboration amid the rising tensions between Russia and USA. So in this context, let us know about the background of this move as well as about the International Space Station. First, let us know about ISS or the International Space Station. See, the idea of a space station was once a science fiction that was existing only in the imagination until it became clear in the 1940s that construction of such a structure might be attainable. And the first rudimentary station was created in 1969 by the linking of two Russian Soyuz vehicles in space, and this was followed by other stations and developments in space technology until the construction began on the ISS in 1998. See, the International Space Station is a modular space station or a habitable artificial satellite in low Earth orbit, and it nearly took 10 years and more than 30 missions to assemble it. Now, this ISS program is a multinational collaborative project between five participating space agencies, which includes NASA from the US, Roscosmos from Russia, JAXA from Japan, ESA from Europe, and the CSA from Canada. See, this ISS has been the most politically complex space exploration program that was ever taken, and also it is a result of unprecedented scientific and engineering collaboration among the five space agencies representing 15 countries. See, the space station is approximately the size of a football field, a 406-ton permanently crewed platform that is orbiting 250 miles above the Earth. And it became fully operational in May 2009 when it began hosting a 6-person crew. And the 6-person crew has typically consisted of 3 Russians, 2 Americans, and 1 astronaut from either Japan, Canada, or the ESA. Now, in this context, Russia is planning to pull out of this rare collaboration between Russia and the West, and also it is planning to build its own space station by 2025. See, Russia has got a glorious past when it comes to space history, and this was evident when Russia became the first country to send a man to orbit. But in recent times, its space programs have lost sheen. Also, Russia had monopoly in sending astronauts to ISS, and recently that was broken by the SpaceX. Also, remember, it is said that the Russian government policies are focusing more on military technologies rather than space. So with this information, let's move on to the next news article. Now, having done with all the above news articles, let us now move on to the special article on Civil Services Day. Since today, that is the 21st of April, is commemorated as the Civil Services Day by the central government. So let us now move on to the article. See, the central government observes April 21st as the Civil Services Day. It is seen as an occasion for civil servants to rededicate themselves to the cause of citizen and renew their commitments to public service and excellence in their work. See, it was on this day that in 1947, India's first Home Minister, Vallabhbhai Patel, had addressed the probationers of administrative services officers at the Metcalfe House in New Delhi. However, it was only in 2006, the first Civil Services Day was celebrated at Vigyan Bhavan at Delhi. See, this is a day to appreciate the tremendous work done by officers who engaged themselves in public administration in the various departments of central and state government. Also note that on National Civil Service Day, the Prime Minister's Award for Excellence in Public Administration are also presented. Now, having that said, let us take a moment and look into the contributions of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel and the award presented on this day every year. Now, firstly, we'll see about the award. See, the Government of India has instituted the Prime Minister's Award for Excellence in Public Administration in the year 2006. And this award was instituted to acknowledge, recognize, and to reward the extraordinary and innovative work that is done by the districts and organizations of the central and state governments. And the scheme was restructured in 2014 for recognizing the performance of district collectors in priority programs, innovations, and aspirational districts. And the scheme has been restructured again in 2020 to recognize the performance of district collectors towards economic development of the district as well. And in essence, the award is presented to recognize the exemplary efforts of the civil servants. Now coming to Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. Vallabhbhai Jawaharbhai Patel, popularly known as Sardar Patel, was born on October 1875 and he was a lawyer by degree. And even after a flourishing experience at Ahmedabad, Vallabhbhai Patel played a very great role in organizing a successful non-cooperation movement in Gujarat, and he also played an important role in Kheda Satyagraha and Bardoli Satyagraha as well. And he also took active part in Dandi March. Note that he was elected as the president of Congress in 1931. Soon after independence, as deputy prime minister and union home minister of India, Sardar Patel united 565 princely states with the mainstream India after the British Raj came to an end. And this earned him the epithet, the Iron Man of India. And in 1991, Sardar Patel was conferred with posthumously Bharat Ratna for his great services towards the nation. No doubt, Sardar Patel left an indelible mark in Indian politics. And as Prime Minister Nehru rightly said, his name will live forever in history. He is the architect of modern India. So with this, we have come to the end of today's news discussion. Let's move on to the discussion of the prelims practice question. Now look at this prelims question. With reference to air bubble pact, often seen in news, consider the following statement. Statement 1, a temporary international bilateral agreement aimed at restarting commercial passenger services suspended in the wake of pandemic. Statement 2, it is signed between countries sharing international land border. So which of the statements given above are incorrect? Now when you look at statement 1, you can find that it is correct. Now coming to statement 2, it is incorrect because there are no such specification for these pacts. If you consider India, it has entered into air bubble arrangements with more than 25 countries, that includes countries like USA, Canada, etc., which does not share international land border with India. So therefore, the right option is option B, that is 2 only. Now look at this question. Sunna Vaddi Panta Runalu scheme or zero interest crop loan scheme that is seen in the news recently is introduced by which of the following state? See, this is a factual question based on a discussion, and we know that the right answer is option A, that is Andhra Pradesh. Now consider the following schemes. Employees provide fund scheme, national pension scheme, employees pension scheme, employees deposit linked insurance scheme. Which of the above is or are administered by the employees provident fund organization? And the right option is option D. See, this employees provident fund organization was launched in 2004 with an objective to provide retirement income to all the citizens, and it is a pension cum investment scheme which brings an attractive long-term saving avenue to effectively plan your retirement through safe and regulated market-based return. And it is regulated by the Pension Fund Regulatory and Development Authority, which comes under the Ministry of Finance. Also, its beneficiaries include any employee from public, private and unorganized sector. And the right answer is option D, that is 1, 3 and 4 only. Now which of the following is correct with reference to maneuvering characteristics augmentation system or MCA is recently seen in news? So from the four options, we can conclude that option A is the right answer because as seen in the discussion, it is a flight control law that is implemented to improve aircraft handling characteristics. So therefore the right answer is option A. Now with reference to International Space Station, consider the following statement. Statement 1, it is a joint effort of space agencies of USA, Russia, India and ESA. Statement 2, it was constructed in 1978. And statement 3, the ISS is fully automated, that it doesn't have a crew stationed at all times. Now, when you look at statement 1, it is incorrect because the Indian Space Agency was not a part of the ISS making mission. And when you look at second statement, this is also incorrect because it started its construction in 1998 only. So this statement is also wrong. Now coming to third statement, see, although it has a high degree of automation, ISS has a permanent crew typically consisting of 3 Russians, 2 Americans and 1 astronaut from Japan, Canada or Europe. So this statement is also wrong. And since the question asked to identify the incorrect statement, the right option is option D, that is all the above. Now with reference to Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, consider the following statements. He was the first Home Minister of India. His role in Bardoli Satyagraha earned him the title Sardar. Which of the statement given above is or are incorrect? See, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel was a deputy prime minister as well as the home minister. And in his capacity of home minister, he played an important role in uniting India that was fragmented in pieces after British rift. Therefore, statement one is correct. Statement two is also correct because Patel took an active part in 1928, Bardoli Satyagraha, which was a part of civil disobedience movement. And Patel was an exemplary commander of his non-violent army in Bardoli, and a large number of women also took active part in the movement. And in fact, it was these women who gave Patel the moniker Sardar. So this statement is also right. And since the question wants us to identify the incorrect statement, the answer is option D, that is neither one nor two. The list of mains practice questions is displayed here. You can write your answers and post them in the comment section below. And with this, we have come to the end of today's Indo News analysis. So if you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates regarding UPSC Civil Services preparation.